Today, I'm going to show you a super quick way to set up PBR textures in Blender. First of all though, we'll need some textures. I'm not sponsored by them, but I usually get free PBR textures from Polyhaven or CG Bootcase. For this example, I downloaded these metal tiles, but you can choose any set of PBR textures you like. One thing to keep in mind is this resolution. I've chosen 4K, which is very high, and pretty much the higher the resolution of your textures, the longer rendering will take in Blender. Once you've downloaded them, you can just right click and press this extract all to unzip the file. Then this menu here will pop up, and you can just choose this browse button to choose where on your computer you would like to save your textures. I have a dedicated folder for all my PBR textures, but you can save it wherever you like, or even just in the downloads folder if you can't think of anywhere. Once you're done, you can just press select folder and then choose extract. Back in Blender, I'm going to enable a free built-in add-on called the Node Wrangler, which will allow us to create a PBR setup really quickly. To enable this add-on, I'll first left-click edit and then choose preferences. Then I'll just left-click add-ons to come to the add-ons tab. Then you can left-click the search bar and just search for Node Wrangler. You can just enable it here by checking this box, and then you can left click the three bars and choose save preferences. This is a handy add-on for other features in Blender as well, so definitely make sure to enable it, especially since you don't have to download anything from the internet. It's already inside of Blender. Now I'm going to add an object to texture, so I'll press Shift A, and then under mesh I'm just going to choose UV sphere. You can see here in the add UV sphere panel, I've increased the segments to 64 and rings to 32, but you can leave it on default if you'd like to keep something more low poly. And then I'm going to right click and then choose shade smooth to give it some nice smooth shading. And I'm going to left click this button here to go into viewport shading. This is really important so we can actually see our textures. Then, in order to add a material, I'm going to change my timeline here to the shader editor. This is a really handy menu for creating changes to our materials. You can also left-click this button here to come into material properties. And this is just a smaller or condensed version of this menu here. You'll notice if I press plus new in here, a material will appear here as well. I'm going to left-click material.002 and just type in the word metal tiles. Then I'm going to left click my principal BSDF, and now we can use the feature of the add-on. All we need to do is press Ctrl, Shift, and then T. And now our file browser will appear, and you can just go ahead and find the textures you unzipped. Double click, and here we'll have our textures. For now, we're going to ignore the ambient occlusion map. You'll notice that we have all these different names. For example, this one's called base color, this one's called height, this one's called normal, and this one's called roughness. Roughness is essentially the reflections of the material. You may also see something called gloss, in which case you'll need an extra step. But I'll show you how to do that. Color will be used to color the material, and there's also one you can get sometimes called metalness. To keep it simple, if you see metalness, base color, and roughness, we're just going to automatically select all those. So I'll left click my base color and then control left click my roughness, and since we don't have a metalness map, we won't need to select that. Then the choice comes between either height or normal. A normal map is a nice way to add some depth by editing the normals. Height does something similar, but it's a bit of a higher quality since it's using a black and white image first. This could either be used with a bump node, or it can be used with a displacement node. You may also see height named as displacement or bump, but in this case is named height. For us though, we're going to choose the normal map. So I'll control left click that to choose normal. I'll explain what to do about height at a later point, but just keep in mind when you select the height map, it's going to automatically add the displacement node, so you will need to set up the bump node separately if you want to do that. Now I've got all my maps selected, I'm just going to press principal texture setup, and you can see it's gone ahead and set up some of these textures. For our base color and our roughness, we're all good to go, but remember I mentioned this thing about a gloss map. If we had to use a gloss map instead of roughness, we'll need to press Shift A, then in the search bar, I'm just going to search for invert, and we're going to plug this in between the roughness and the roughness input. As you can see, this has ruined the reflections, and that's because we're using a roughness map, not a gloss map. The reason why we need to do this in the first place, though, is because gloss maps are essentially just the inverse of a roughness map. So we need to use an invert node in Blender in order to make it compatible, since Blender works with roughness instead of gloss by default. I'm going to go ahead and press X to delete the invert color node, and I'm going to plug my color back into roughness. Before we move on to normal, you also notice we don't have any metal, and these tiles we have were metal, and that's because it didn't come with a metal map, which it sometimes will. Thankfully though, since it's pretty much metal everywhere, we can just go ahead and set this metallic slider to 1. One problem you will see though is it kind of looks like these things that are supposed to be grooves are actually sticking out. The reason for this, if I come back to my browser here where I've got my brushed metal tiles download, you can see that with a description of all our maps here, the normal has this word DirectX beside it, and you see Blender works with a type of normal map called OpenGL. Some softwares do use DirectX though, so nothing extra will need to be done for them. But because we're using Blender, we're going to need to do an extra step for DirectX. If here your normal says OpenGL, you won't have to do anything else. Your normal map will already be set up. Since our normal map is DirectX, let's go ahead and get that set up. So the difference between a DirectX and an OpenGL normal map is the green channel is inverted. So we'll need to flip that channel so it pretty much simulates an OpenGL normal map. I'm going to left click and box like these nodes, and then press G to move them along. Now, we're going to need to add a few extra nodes to invert the green channel. So I'll press Shift A, and then under Converter, you can either choose Separate XYZ or Separate Color. If you choose Separate XYZ, just think of Y as green, X as red, and Z as blue. For us though, we'll use Separate Color to keep it nice and simple. Then the second thing we need in our normal map recipe is the Combine Color node. So I'll press Shift A, and then I'm going to left click Search, and search for Combine, and you can choose Combine Color. Then I'm going to plug red into red, green into green, and blue into blue. Essentially what this node does, if I plug my normal into color, and then color back into color of the normal map node, right now nothing's changed, as pretty much all that's happening is the normal map is going into this node, it's then separating the color information into the red, green, and blue channels, and then it comes into this node here, where the red, green, and blue channels are combined again, and it's turned back into color information. Then it goes into the normal map, which calculates how it's going to look on our object. So if we want to make it so the green channel is inverted, all we need to do is press Shift A, then search and search for invert, and then I'm going to plug this invert color onto this green line here. That's fixed our problem, and now the tiles are sticking out instead of the grooves. So dealing with DirectX and gloss maps can sometimes be a bit of a pain, but thankfully it's quite simple once you know what the process is, and it's why it's so important to make sure you understand what all of your maps are. I'm going to zoom out here, and if you want your tiles to be a little bit smaller because some of these are quite stretched, all I need to do is zoom in, and I can maybe change the X scale here to 2. If you're familiar with the UV editor, this would be essentially the same as coming into the UV editor, pressing S, X, and then 2 to scale it twice on the X axis. But the handy feature about doing this with the node is you can always change it easily later. If you want to know how to set up the extra settings for displacement and bump, you can check out my video on bump and displacement here. Apart from that, I would like to thank you all very much for watching, and I hope you have a nice day. Take care.